Hello, and welcome to Prairie Post. Coming up a little bit later in the show, we'll hear the sounds of the Fargo-Moorhead Jazz Arts Big Band. But first, joining me now is a board member from the Northern Plains Botanic Garden Society. And John, I apologize, but I'm going to let you say your last name. Okay. Give us your name.
It's John Zviroski.
There you go. And I said I'd have been close, but you did a much better job of it. You know, thanks for joining us today. And this is an interesting topic that I think a lot of people probably don't know about, so we want to expand that. Tell the folks, as we get started, a little bit about yourself and your background.
Okay. I've pretty much always been involved in gardening. It's just kind of a passion of the past. And through schooling, I went for horticulture, environment design, landscape architecture. So I have kind of a detailed background in that. Been involved with a lot of volunteer activities. Northern Plains Botanic Garden Society is one of them. I'm in Jamestown now, so I do a lot with the Arts Center Arts Park that they have downtown and maintain that. Pretty much promoting a lot to do with horticulture, getting people involved and how it affects their lives and such. Last June, I was awarded the first Advanced Master Gardening Certificate in the state of North Dakota. So that kind of gets a lot of people to ask more questions and stuff like that. So it's definitely been a plus as far as getting people involved in various activities. So that's pretty much the detailed background of where I come from. Originally from Fargo, been in Jamestown for just 5 years now.
Now, I understand, of course, you're on the board of directors of the society. How long have you been on the board?
I've been on the board for about a year now.
Okay, about a year. So, but let's start off with telling the folks out there exactly what is the Northern Plains Botanic Garden Society.
The society itself is the organization of people that developed this group back in 1998. And it was headed by Shiwan Lee and a group of people at that time that were highly involved in horticulture. And their vision was basically to bring in a botanic garden into the city of Fargo-Moorhead to educate people and to get people involved with their surroundings and learning at the same time. Basically, the botanical garden, that's what they entail. They have educational features, they have classes, they want you to get involved so you can learn things from as basic as planting a marigold seed to as advanced as knowing horticulture, genealogies, and diversification and such like that. So however advanced you want to be, that can be your involvement in it. But you by no means have to be an expert to be involved. Since then, the organization has developed gardens. So the Northern Plains Botanic Gardens are a product of the society itself. That land for the gardens was developed in or acquired in 2006.
All right. Well, let's get to that in a minute, I think. Let's talk about, you said it was in 1998 you just started, so you're relatively new.
Correct.
Yep. When you really think about it. But talk about the funding. How are you funded? How does it
exist? The funding to that is pretty much through donation and membership. Mm-hmm. So that's basically how it is. Everybody that we have currently are all volunteers. We have no paid staff on board. Mm-hmm. So we really are dependent on the general public. And that's not necessarily just from the Fargo-Moorhead area. It's a very broad range because it is a regional setting as far as just a local setting.
And I say, no, you're not that new, but young enough, I guess.
Yeah, when you look at 13 years, mm-hmm. you know, it takes a while to plant the seed and start getting it growing to where you actually have something that's substantial and tangible that people can see. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't just go out there and plant a garden and say, all right, whoever wants to come out, you know, do it. And then when it doesn't get done, then, you know, you're kind of stuck.
Now, how many members do you have? And, well, how would somebody out there become a member?
Currently, there are about 325 members. You can become a member by contacting any of the 325, contacting the board, or you can go to our website. We do have membership forms on there. The website, of course, is Northern Plains Botanic Garden Society. Mm-hmm. Those are the main things. Of course, we solicit. However, you know, if we see an interest, of course, we're going to ask you if you want to get involved and go from there. One of the issues we have with that is a lot of people are afraid to become members because they're always like, main comment, I don't have time. Mm-hmm. And the big thing is we want to really encourage people to become a member to support the project. If you have time to volunteer hours and stuff like that, that's completely up to you, but it's by no means a pressure status that you become a member, now you have to do all these things. We really look for the support in the community that say this is a project that they want to support. And if somewhere down the road they want to get involved in volunteer time, then by all means we encourage that and we welcome them aboard to whatever project they may be interested in.
Okay. We were talking about some land, and I guess there's some land that you've purchased between 28th Avenue and 32nd Avenue in Fargo, is my understanding. And what's been built there over the last few years?
Right now, there's three phases of the land. It's 52 acres. Okay. And it's in a partnership with the Parks Board. Mm-hmm. So it's not land that we own. It's a land that we're contracted through with the Park Boards.
Okay.
We basically maintain the entire area. The first development is phase one, and that would be the southern portion of that, and that's going to be along 28th Avenue North. Mm-hmm. That acreage there is probably about 12 acres at this time. Phase two is another 30 acres, and the last phase is about another 20. Right now we have the Rain Gardens, the Alaris Financial Butterfly Gardens, a chrysanthemum testing gardens to see how winter hardy they are and how they come through, a gladiola garden, an alphabet garden, which is done in partnership with Yunker Farm, which is adjacent to us. Mm-hmm. They're their gardens, we maintain and keep them up, so we kind of share them between the two. And then we have a really nice woodland garden in the front corner. Project two, of course, is the Japanese gardens that we are going to be heading towards.
Well, let's talk about that in a minute, but let's back up, I guess. So you're encouraging, and you want people to go here.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yep, and there's things there right now. So, you know, from spring until fall, there's always something changing and something going on. And, you know, if you want to walk through, it's free admittance. You can wander through anytime. There's usually a staff on site sometime during the day helping out in the gardens or in the greenhouse or something of that nature. You know, if you want to pluck a weed while you go through, feel free.
Well, okay. Now, you mentioned the Rain Garden and I guess the Alphabet Garden at Yunker Farms. Can you expand on that a little bit and tell us what that's all about?
The Alphabet Garden is a garden that has all plants from A to Z. So it's divided up with a plot that has all plants that start with A, and then there's a plot next to it that start with B, and it kind of goes down the way. And it's kind of an educational tool for whether it's kids or adults alike that can go through and familiarize themselves with various plants from the letters of the alphabet. Mm-hmm. Originally, it's for kids to get involved because, you know, that's where we want to start them and get them rooted into a lifelong project. The Rain Gardens are actually part of the Northern Plains Botanic Garden. They're not part of Yunker Farm. They are right next to the greenhouse just east of it. Mm-hmm. And they're basically watered through runoff, is how rain gardens are developed. The runoff goes and saturates the soil, and those plants are much more water tolerant and such. So that's where that's located.
Well, so we can say you've got something there for kids of all ages.
Yes. Yep.
Now, but you talked about water. You know, obviously, we've had a lot of water this year. How has that affected your gardens?
With the rain gardens, they have a natural drainage system also. The rain gardens are actually raised. So the runoff from around the greenhouse and such actually flows through the garden. If it becomes too saturated, it flows through the bottom. So it almost has a drain tile if it becomes overly saturated. So it's never, ever sitting in water. It's just moisture retentive. And a lot of that is from compost, from the local composting site and such.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, if we can just learn all our communities to do that, we could get rid of some of this water we got around. Let's talk about some of your current projects. One thing you're focusing on is increasing membership, is my understanding, and to get sort of the public interested to as a destination to come to the gardens. Is that not right?
That is correct.
Yeah, tell us about what you're doing there.
Okay. Basically, we are getting out with the Chamber of Commerce, the FM Visitors Convention Bureau and such like that, because we want people that are coming to visit the town to be aware that this is a destination that they'll want to come to. And right now, you know, the gardens may be small, but it's still something to see. And they'll always be growing from this point forward. So you may see it, you know, this year, in 2 years you may come back and it's completely different. So we really want people to get involved and to know that the FM area actually has gardens that they can go to. Because currently right now there aren't any gardens that people can go to and enjoy unless you go to a private residence or you pass some of the park board, you know, beds that are around town, but there isn't a garden per se. And we want this to be a place where people can go, enjoy, learn a little, relax, go paint, take photography, you know, there's a whole realm of options available to people by going to the gardens.
Well, now you talk about bringing people in and expanding it. I mean, how far do you draw? I mean, how many people are, how far does the reach go, I guess?
Right now, the closest botanic gardens are Minneapolis-St. Paul area and up in Winnipeg. Okay. And then otherwise you're looking over at Denver. We have that entire region in between that there are no botanic gardens. And so we want to fill that niche and kind of get into the central position and start developing this and bring in people from that radius. And plus we have members that support us all the way from California, New York, Florida, England, Canada. So they're not just FM members. We do have members that may have their roots from the FM area and have moved away, and they still want to support these projects because they still have family that live in the area that knows that they can benefit from it.
Okay. You may have mentioned this, but let's expand on this. Project you're in the construction of, my understanding, the Japanese gardens or the garden gardens of the mind and soul?
Yeah, it's the Garden of Mind and Soul. Okay. And what it is a 2-acre site that'll be developed on the south end along 28th Avenue. Currently, 3 years ago, the Japanese gates, it's a secondary entrance, were put up. And that will be the back side of the gardens, and then the north side will be the entrance when it is developed. It's called the Garden of Mind and Soul, and it's designed in the Japanese style, so it's not a Japanese garden per se, because all the plants in it obviously have to be of northern variety and something mm-hmm. that's winter hardy, you know, for our region. The gardens themselves will contain a pavilion, which is going to be a gathering spot for between 300 and 400 people for receptions, gatherings, art exhibits, horticultural exhibits, classes. So there's a huge range of availability for this site. And of course, it's going to have a Japanese theme to it. It's also going to have a gift shop that's going to have a lot of items that'll promote the botanic gardens and of botanic nature, you know, whether it be literature, postcards, cards, you know, a variety of things would be available there. The gardens themselves would have numerous pathways in it, 3 ponds that are intertied together with waterfalls. Mm-hmm. It would have an open grass setting and then the miniature pruned gardens that would surround the water and beyond. But it'll have a very large expanse of opportunities available. With the grassland, of course, you can have larger gatherings even out in the facility itself, or you can venture off, you know, someplace where it's a little more secluded, you know, if you just want to be on your own and kind of reflect on things.
Okay, and with that then, is it for rent, so to speak? I mean,
yeah,
people
the facility will be have rental fees, whether you want to have a wedding reception there, a reunion, whatever the case may be, or maybe you just want to have some sort of art exhibit that's, you know, your own personal endeavor and you want space to do that, you know, we would have the facilities to do that.
Okay. Now, I understand you're putting 3 more beds in the front of the Japanese gardens for the spring blast celebration?
Yeah. Right now, we are in the process. In fact, this coming weekend, we're going to be planting nearly 2,000 spring bulbs. And we have 3 beds in the front of the current gates that are out there that are going to line 28th Avenue. And basically the reason for that is to get people aware, you know, right away in the springtime when all these flowers are, you know, in a burst of color, we want to get people out into that site, pull them in, start to research what is out there right now, you know, if they like to support that, you know, if it's something that they really believe that the area needs. And of course, the more support we have, the faster the progress grows as far as how we expand on that.
What about the cost of beds like this and a project like that?
The cost of the beds, you know, we have to be within budgetary constraints. You know, they are covered and they aren't as expensive as you may think, you know, for something like that. Our expense comes in maintenance, you know, and it's not necessarily in the dollar portion. It's the volunteer maintenance, you know, to keep up the gardens. Because, of course, we want those gardens to look nice at all times because we can see a weedy garden in our own yard. We don't want to go visit someplace and see that. So, you know, our utmost epitome there is to keep everything clean and neat so people can wander through and just enjoy what they see. Okay. Of course, you know, as far as funding, once again, you know, the Japanese gardens and such like that are going to be funded by donations from businesses, individuals, you know, wherever we can get those, of course.
See, the more you tell me about it, the more I want to get my family out there and go through this. But, you know, I mean, do you compete with other gardens, so to speak, or is it just something that, that you want to have available for people to...
There really isn't a competition of gardens just based on the range. Now, you know, if we were building a garden in Maple Grove, Minneapolis, you know, you'd be competing with the gardens, you know, of the metropolitan area of Minneapolis. But since there are no botanical gardens, per se, in this area, there are various gardens that people can go and wander through and such like that. They're not necessarily a place of education. They don't always have people on site, you know, to ask every, you know, detail about them. Things aren't necessarily labeled, you know, so you can see, oh, I'm looking at this or whatever. But the botanic garden is actually a place to either relax or to become educated on things.
Mm-hmm. Sure, sounds great. What other projects are you involved in there with the society?
With the society, of course, there's fundraising, giving speeches, getting our name out into the public eye. I personally deal with the public relations area, getting all of our classes and workshops out, advertising for our fundraising events, just talking to people in general, whether it's here or on the western side of the state, or if I take a trip someplace, you know, I'll talk about it there, and if I can gather a member, I'll take them in. And of course, when you spread the word like that, if you give people enough information, they get interested and spread it a little bit further. So it's a nice rolling effect once that gets going.
Now, what about regular meetings? I assume the board has regular meetings, but what about members? Can you tell us?
We have board meetings every third Thursday of the month.
Okay.
And those are open to anybody on the membership. And if you're interested in becoming a member and want to sit in on one, you're more than free to do so. We hold them in the summer times at the greenhouse on site. Of course, when it's winter time, then we have our offices right now down at the NRI building. It's the Neuropsychiatric Institute across from Island Park Swimming Pool. Sure. And we have a room right off of the atrium that we maintain there.
Okay. Well, John, why do you, you know, most of us garden a little bit, or you know, don't have the green thumb that y'all have. But why do you think a lot of people are interested in gardening and growing things?
I think one of the things that really pulls people in is when they're in the garden, a lot of their cares seem to drift away. You know, they go, they start working, whether they're weeding or deadheading plants or just looking at what's progressing in their yard. I think it really takes people away. And, you know, if they have a troubled day or whatever, they can go there and relax. And, you know, an hour spent in the garden can pretty much alleviate a lot of the stress, you know, without medication. So you might as well go for it because it's usually free. Of course, like I said, right now, the botanic gardens are free admission. So, you know, even if you have a bad day, wander through it. You know, you can come down there, park for free, and wander through it for free. And you might like what you see.
Well, John, your background's there, but do you remember what got you involved or when you first started gardening?
I think I've always been surrounded about it. You know, I had parents that were involved in gardening, you know, more on the vegetable side and such like that. And, you know, as time went on, you know, we moved and the garden got bigger, you know, from a little 20 by 15 foot plot to a 1 acre plot. And all of a sudden you had to work into it. And you start developing a liking, you know, of what you can do with the earth and watching things progress and going from there. So I think it can become very addictive once you get into it, even if you don't know a lot about it, you know, because not anybody really is an expert, because things change every day, whether it's the weather or how a plant grows or your soils or location. Every day is something different.
Well, John, we're running out of time, but if people, tell people again, how can they become members and at what levels are you
okay.
looking for?
Membership, for a single membership, it's $20. If you're a student, and that's a student from first grade all the way through college, if you're an older than average student, that's in adult ed, that is $10 for a student membership. Family membership is $35, and of course, from there, you can go up. Okay. And we'll take donations of any amount at any time. If you want to join, you can go directly to our website. Just Google Northern Plains Botanic Garden Society or the initials NPBGS, and it's the first site that pulls up. You just go into our enrollment, and we can make you a member.
John, thank you so much for joining us today. Look forward to getting out there.
Thank you.
Stay tuned for more. The Fargo Moorhead Jazz Arts Big Band pays tribute to the classical sounds of Lawrence Welk and his orchestra. Led by Kyle Mack, the jazz band was formed in 1991 and is comprised of 18 members and a variety of guest singers.
Here's Lawrence Welk's Bubbles in the Wine. Next is This Old House featuring Meryl Pepcorn.
This old house once knew my children. This old house once knew my wife. This old house was home and comfort as we fought the storms of life. This old house once rang with laughter. This old house heard many shouts. Now she trembles in the darkness when the lightning walks about. Ain't gonna need this house no longer. Ain't gonna need this house no more. Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the floor. Ain't got time to oil the hinges nor to mend that window pane. Ain't gonna need this house no longer. I'm a getting ready to meet the saints. This old house is a-getting shaky. This old house is a-getting old. This old house lets in the rain, and this old house lets in the cold. On my knees I'm a-getting chilly, but I feel no fear or pain. I see an angel peeking through that broken window pane. Ain't a gonna need this house no longer. Ain't a gonna need this house no more. Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the floor. Ain't got time to oil the hinges nor to mend that window pane. Ain't a gonna need this house no longer. I'm a getting ready to meet the saints. This old house is afraid of thunder. This old house is afraid of storms. This old house just groans and trembles when the night wind flings her arms. This house is a-getting feeble. This old house is a-needing paint. Just like me, it's a-tuckered out, but I'm a-getting ready to meet the saints. Well, I ain't gonna need this house no longer. Ain't gonna need this house no more. Ain't got time to fix the shingles. Ain't got time to fix the door. Ain't got time to oil the hinges nor to mend the window pane. Ain't gonna need this house no longer. I'm getting ready to meet the saints.
Here's a Cole Porter tune made famous by Artie Shaw. Begin the Begin.
Thank you.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulse for this week. And as always, thanks for watching.
Funding for Minnesota Legacy programs are provided by a grant from the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008, North Dakota Council on the Arts, and by the members of Prairie Public.